welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, Brian Lynn has a report about the moon's atmosphere. Anna Mateo and Mario Ritter Jr. present the health and lifestyle report. We close the show with a visit to Acadia National Park as our U.S. National Parks journey continues. But first, this report. Like other 3D printers, the Vulcan printer puts down layer by layer of materials to build an object. However, this printer is more than 13.7 meters wide and prints homes for people to live in. This summer, the robotic printer from the home builder Icon will complete the last of the 100 3D printed houses in Wolf Ranch, a community about 48 kilometers from Austin, Texas. Icon began printing the walls of what it says is the world's largest 3D printed community in November 2022. Compared to traditional home building, the company says, 3D printing is faster, less costly, requires fewer workers, and reduces waste. Connor Jenkins, a project leader, said, "It brings a lot of efficiency to the trade market. So when there were maybe five different crews coming in to build a wall system, we now have one crew and one robot." After concrete, powder, water, sand, and other additives are mixed together and put into the printer, a device called a nozzle releases the concrete mixture. The process looks like toothpaste being put onto a toothbrush, as the printer builds up the house layer by layer along an exact path. The 3 to 4 bedroom homes take about 3 weeks to finish printing, with the foundation and metal roofs put in place with traditional building methods. Jenkins said the concrete walls are designed to be resistant to water, mold, insects, and extreme weather. Lawrence Norzad, 32, and his girlfriend Angela Hontes, 29, purchased a Wolf Ranch home earlier this summer. "It feels like a fortress," Norzad said, adding that he was confident the home would hold up to severe weather conditions. The walls also provide strong insulation from the Texas heat, the couple said. The materials keep the inside temperature cool, even when the air conditioner is not put on high levels. There was one other thing the 3D printed walls seemed to protect against, however: a solid wireless internet connection. Norzad said, "Obviously these are really strong, thick walls, and that's what provides a lot of value for us as homeowners and keeps this thing really well insulated in a Texas summer. But signal doesn't transfer through these walls very well." To deal with this issue, an Icon spokeswoman said most Wolf Ranch homeowners use mesh internet routers. These routers broadcast a signal from several units placed throughout a home, whereas a traditional router sends a signal from one device. The 3D printed homes at Wolf Ranch cost from $450,000 to nearly $600,000. Developers said a little more than one quarter of the 100 homes have been sold. Icon, which 3D printed its first home in Austin in 2018, hopes to one day take its technology to the moon. NASA, as part of its Artemis Moon Exploration Program, has an agreement for ICON to develop a system capable of building landing pads, shelters, and other structures on the moon's surface.
Scientists say new examinations of soil collected on the moon suggest its atmosphere might have been created by repeated meteorite strikes. Researchers studying the moon first used instruments to confirm it had an atmosphere in the early 1970s. The American Space Agency, NASA, explains the moon's atmosphere is very thin and weak. It is technically considered an exosphere. The newly examined soil was collected by NASA astronauts during America's Apollo program from 1969 to 1972. The trips resulted in astronauts capturing about 382 kilograms of rocks and soil called samples. Instead of attempting to measure the moon's atmosphere in a direct way, investigators looked to the old soil material. They theorized that the soil should contain residue material from atoms released into the lunar atmosphere over billions of years. The research was led by scientists at the University of Chicago and Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT. Their results recently appeared in a study in the publication Science Advances. Nicole Nee was the lead writer of the study. She is a planetary scientist at MIT. Nee said that when meteorites impact or hit an object like the moon, they create very high temperatures. Such strikes can heat up the surface by 2,000 to 6,000 degrees Celsius. These extreme temperatures melt and vaporize rocks at the surface and release atoms contained in dust and soil into the atmosphere. Some of the atoms end up being pushed into space, while others remain just above the surface. The researchers said the soil examinations led to the discovery that the moon's atmosphere was formed through a process known as impact vaporization. Nee and her team centered their examinations on two main elements, potassium and rubidium. These substances were chosen because they can easily be vaporized by meteorite hits. The process involved studying the behaviors of different kinds of isotopes found in potassium and rubidium. That study persuaded the team that repeated meteorite strikes formed the atmosphere. In the past, studies have shown the moon's atmosphere might have been created by either meteor activity or the solar wind. Solar wind describes a continuous flow of charged particles from the sun that spreads across the solar system. The researchers said the latest study provides new evidence that most of the lunar atmosphere was likely formed by repeated meteorite hits over billions of years. After testing 10 samples of lunar soil, the team concluded that much more of the atmosphere is due to meteor activity than to the solar wind. At least 70% of the lunar atmosphere is created by these meteorite impacts, Nee said in a statement. A much smaller percentage is created by the solar wind abrasion of the surface, she added. Nicholas Dofa is a professor of geophysical sciences at the University of Chicago. He helped lead the research. Dofa said, "It turns out the answer to this long-standing question was right in front of us, preserved in lunar soil brought back to Earth by the Apollo missions." Nee said understanding such processes can be extremely valuable to planning future missions to the Moon, Mars, and beyond. If humans want to move to different planetary bodies someday, we will have to understand what's going on at the surface to be able to prepare. She added, "Each planetary body is different, and the more we understand about these processes, the more complete picture we'll have." I'm Brian Lynn.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. Working from home, in a small apartment, is fine during the day. But when nighttime comes, it may be more difficult to turn off work and get a good night's sleep. This can be especially difficult in a studio apartment. In a studio apartment, the living room, kitchen, and sleeping area are all in one room. These kinds of apartments are common in large cities with a high cost of living. With electronics, kitchen items, clothes, and books all in one space, it can be hard to create a restful place for sleep. Kim Cook, a reporter for the Associated Press, asked sleep experts and interior design experts for advice on how to work productively and sleep well in a small one-room area.
Everyone needs good sleep to stay healthy. The primary rule, maybe the only rule of small space design, is people have to be honest about how they really live, says Olivia Hoskin. She is deputy managing editor of House Beautiful. She adds that when you have limited space, you need furniture that works well in the room. She suggests spending money on a high-quality bed. Even better is a high-quality sleep sofa that can double as a bed and couch. She does not suggest big tables or chairs that you may not use. Andrea Morris is an interior designer with Lancaster Place Interiors in Wilmington, North Carolina. For studio apartments, she likes wall beds. These can be folded up next to a wall when not in use. They are better known as Murphy beds, named after William Murphy, He came up with this idea in 1900, while living in his own studio apartment in San Francisco, California.
To separate your sleep area from the rest of the apartment, you can purchase a freestanding screen or room divider. And as much as you can, keep your sleep area strictly for sleeping, experts say. Jeff Kahn is co-founder of the Chicago-based sleep research company Rise Science. His company developed a sleep tracking app called Rise. His suggestion is to avoid doing work or anything stressful from your bed. He said that this helps the brain connect your bed with only sleep, rather than wakefulness and work. However, that is not always possible. If you use your bed during the daytime, you can do small things to keep your daytime tasks and sleep separate. Lisa Strauss is a psychologist and expert in sleep disorders. She suggests using one side of the bed for reading and the other for sleeping. You can also bring out special blankets and pillows used only for sleeping. Kahn also suggests keeping a clean, peaceful environment. For starters, he says to make sure the airflow is good. Make sure your space is well ventilated, and consider an air purifier, says Kahn. He adds that this is especially important if you cook and sleep in the same place. Another interior expert is Mia Ingui. She is editor at Spruce, a home design website. She suggests using calming smells like lavender or chamomile at bedtime to set the tone for restful sleep. Also, be sure that computer, TV, and other electronic screens are turned off. In a small room, these devices are probably a short distance from the bed. Their light at night can affect our internal clocks or circadian rhythm.
Do not forget about the sounds these devices make. If the buzz of nearby devices, appliances, or street sounds keep you awake, consider a noise machine. Ingui likes the Hatch Restore, a sunrise lamp that provides soothing sounds and lights up slowly in the morning. You can also buy noise-canceling curtains. These cut down on outside noises. Andrea Morris, the home designer, says one thing to avoid when it comes to studio living is leaving beds unmade. It's amazing how much better you feel after a hard day entering a space with a made bed, she said. At night, she suggests putting away electronics. Side tables with plugs and ports for electronics help you store devices and keep things tidy or organized and clean. This is another example of choosing furniture that has multiple uses. If it is difficult to control your studio apartment's heating and cooling, Ingui recommends choosing materials for bedding that let the skin breathe. Such materials can keep you cool in warm weather and warm in cooler temperatures. She also suggests buying several pieces of bedding that are easy to store rather than big, bulky blankets. Studio apartments often do not have a lot of storage.
With some thoughtful choices, your small space can have the feeling we all want from home life: calm, clean, and good for both working and sleeping. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Ana. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. On our national parks journey, we are exploring the oldest national park east of the Mississippi River. Much of the park sits on a rocky island off the coast of Maine, called Mount Desert Island. Here, you will find the tallest mountain on the east coast. You will also find black bears, moose, and more than 300 kinds of birds. This national park also holds unique Native American and European history. It is called Acadia. The 14,000-hectare park is one of the smaller major national parks in the country. Yet Acadia sees almost 3 million visitors every year. They come to experience stunning views and take part in outdoor activities like hiking and biking and swimming in the crisp blue Atlantic Ocean.
Acadia National Park has had many names throughout history. It was first declared a national monument in 1916. Its name, Sierre des Monts National Monument, was changed by Congress in 1919. It then became known as Lafayette National Park. In 1929, the park became Acadia National Park, from a past name for the area. The name Acadia probably comes from Arcadia, an area of Greece. It is said that an Italian explorer working for the King of France sailed by the area in 1524. The explorer thought that the landscape looked like the Greek area of Arcadia.
Mount Desert Island also got its name from early European explorers. Frenchman Samuel Champlain arrived on the island in 1604. He described the island's tall peaks as bare and rocky. He named the island, in French, Île des Monts Déserts, or Island of Desert Mountains. Today, locals still say the word desert, similar to its French pronunciation, Desert. Champlain and his team were not, of course, the first humans on the island. Native Americans were the first to inhabit the area. Shells and other archaeological evidence on the island date back more than 5,000 years. The native Wabanaki people arrived there in boats made from the wood of birch trees. They hunted, fished, collected berries, and harvested clams from the sea. Wabanaki people called the island Pemetic, or sloping land.
This sloping land is home to Cadillac Mountain. It is the highest point along America's eastern coast at 466 meters. The island owes its landscape to ancient glaciers that once covered the area. Cadillac Mountain is known as the first point in the U.S. that is touched by the rising sun each morning. The name of its early inhabitants, the Wabanaki, translates to People of the Dawn. Today, the summit of Cadillac Mountain is often packed with visitors, many of whom arrive in cars and buses. It is one of the major tourist attractions within the park.
Many tourists also visit what may be the most photographed rock in the state. Bubble Rock is a giant boulder. It sits right on the edge of the summit of South Bubble Mountain. It was moved here by powerful ancient glaciers. Bubble Rock looks as though the slightest wind may push it over the mountain's edge. Visitors often take photos of themselves trying to push the huge rock off the mountain. Of course, Bubble Rock does not move. The Bubble Rock Trail winds up South Bubble Mountain. It is one of the most popular hiking trails in the park. But Acadia does offer solitude for visitors hoping to enjoy the quiet of nature. Within the park are more than 200 kilometers of trails. Many lead to stunning views of the rocky main coast. Some take you to pebbled beaches or quiet lakes surrounded by forest.
Many visitors to Acadia spend most of their time exploring Mount Desert Island. But the Skudik Peninsula is equally beautiful. The National Park Service now protects more than 1,300 hectares of land there. Skudik offers secluded beaches and peaceful hiking trails.
In summer months, visitors can take a boat from the town of Bar Harbor on Mount Desert Island to the town of Winter Harbor on Skudik Peninsula. The tiny fishing town is a great place to enjoy Maine lobster in many forms. A few small family-owned restaurants serve classic Maine dishes like lobster soup, lobster rolls, or simple steamed lobster. But wherever visitors explore in Acadia, they will leave wishing they could see more. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.